please. I don't want to take any of your minutes.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nevins. I want to first thank Dr. Jean Salcetti and her committee for inviting me. This is one of the culminations of my career. It ranks right up there with getting out of dental school, graduating dental school, getting my perio residency completed, having my children, finishing my alimony payments, getting my board certification, which I just got in 2014. I thought it was very important for me to get board certified. And now I'd be able to speak in front of this auspicious group with two previous presidents of the AAP, two well-known people. I mean, this is really my, this is it, this is my Everest. So anyway, I'm gonna get right to it. This is me. What this doesn't say is I'm not running for any political office. I'm not trying to be a trustee at the AAP. So do I have to be really politically correct? Not really. So I'm hoping that you'll kind of take a look and have an open mind of what I'm going to talk about. Oh, there's my slides. Here's my disclosure. I'm an independent consultant for Millennium Dental Technologies. I do give lectures for them. And I am an instructor for the Institute for Advanced Laser Dentistry. And those are my disclosures there. I want to show this first. Oh, there it is. That's what I was looking for. I show this because it's important. It's funny, but it's important that whatever laser you're going to get, I don't care if you get a diode, erbium, NDX, whatever, get proper training. Because even the most innocuous laser can cause a lot of damage to your patients. So training, whichever laser you're going to get, is, to me, tantamount. One thing I want to say is this. I talk to a lot of doctors, a lot of meetings, a lot of lectures, and when you say the word laser, they just kind of lump in all lasers into one category. And they're not all. They're all different. There's no such device in laser dentistry or medicine where one laser is equally good at treating all tissues equally well. Each laser has its own niche. Nothing happens, if that's true anyway, without hearing anything about laser physics, you're wrong. So nothing happens to laser energy unless it's absorbed. And that's important. That's dependent on the wavelength, the tissue composition, the pigmentation, the water content. Nothing happens, only when that laser energy is absorbed. So everyone's seen this before. Everything below this blue line, nothing happens. There's no absorption whatsoever. I'm not really going to talk about the CO2s. It's not represented. It really had, to me, the CO2s really have nothing to do with perio, in my opinion. It's a great laser for what it does, but for treating perio, not the laser I would even choose. So I'm just going to skip right to the erbiums. Erbiums, wonderful laser. Highly absorbed in water, like Dr. Clem said, which is great, but we're mostly made of water. So the penetration of an erbium is surface. It has to keep drilling down. It's micro explosions. That's how it works. It's also well absorbed hydroxyapatite. Fantastic. If I want to remove bone, great. If I was a pediatric dentist, an erbium would be the first laser I would buy because that will do soft tissue work, phrenectomies, gingivectomies, etc. And it will help to remove decay from my kids' teeth in a cool way, maybe without some anesthetic. But it's still going to remove bone. Some people say it'll scale and root plane, get rid of calculus. But it can't differentiate between calculus and tooth structure. So it's going to, and if you're in a closed environment and you're not following it, you're going to keep removing calculus and not know if you're removing tooth structure at all. To me, it's not the laser I would use if I wanted to treat periodontitis. The laser that I use, and the wavelength that I use, is the NDN. The NDN is not well absorbed in water, so it's going to pass through water until it hits its target tissue where it's absorbed, and that's important. It's also moderately absorbed in hemoglobin. That's also very important because it allows us to develop a fibrin clot, which you'll see later actually is developing the patient's own little membrane around the tooth. Surface effects only on the CO2 and the erbiums, whereas the ND-YAG has deep penetration in pigmented tissue over a millimeter, in unpigmented tissue or undiseased tissue over 4 to 5 millimeters. So we're going to get bacteria killed past that point of contact. What does it mean clinically? It's transparent to water and cell membranes, such as the endothelial cells and macrophages, without damaging them. It's highly absorbed in dark pigment. such as severely inflamed tissue, such as black pigmented bacteria. It's well-drawn hemoglobin allows to develop that fibrin clot and stop bleeding on patients. And it's not well-drawn connective tissue because in perio, I want that connective tissue. I don't want to damage it. That's what's going to be my brand new attachment back to my tooth surface and decrease my pocket tips. I show this because the NDAG, this particular NDAG, the periolase, is the one that was specifically designed to treat perio. Other lasers on the market were designed before, and then they tried to figure out to do something with it. This one, all the parameters were developed, and then they built the laser to fit those parameters. No other laser can do this trick. I'm gonna tell you that. It's not magic, it's physics. Here we go. That's how specific this laser is. You can't do it with an erbium, you can't do it with a CO2, and you can't do it with a diode. That's where absorption happens, and that's physics, and that's immutable. The thermogenic clot that we develop is a fibrin clot. It's a dense fibrin clot. What you're seeing here, this little powder, is after doing occlusal adjustment on these cases, just like we do with any regeneration cases, and that powder is just sitting on top of this gelatinous fibrin clot that's sealing off the environment. It's keeping the gingival tissue from growing down and allowing the defect to heal from the pocket to heal from the base of the defect up. It's the patient's own membrane. If you look at Cobb's article here, there's no consistent evidence supporting the routine use of either erbium in the treatment of periodontitis, either as an alternative therapy, monotherapy, or adjunct to traditional scaling and replant. But he does say, in a critical review of the peer-reviewed evidence, indicates that LINAC might be considered an alternate treatment modality for chronic periodontitis. You're entitled to your opinion, but you're not entitled to your own facts. So what I'm going to show you today are some facts and my experiences as a regular periodontist working out there day in, day out. I don't do a lot of implants in my practices. I save teeth because my patients can't afford 10, 12, whatever, thousands of dollars to get full mouth reconstructions. They need to save their teeth, and I have to find ways to do that for them. If we look at here, so the procedure I use with the NDAG is laser-assisted new attachment procedure. So if anyone's triggered, find your safe space. But LINAC works and LINAC exists. It's not something that we put under the rug. If we look at the article here by Dr. Cao in the Periodontal Regeneration, this technique is intriguing in that it is another approach to minimally invasive surgical therapies as reviewed by Cordelli. A minimally invasive surgical approach may offer advantages in regeneration of defects in the aesthetic zone. We don't do a lot of surgery in the aesthetic zone because we don't want to ruin the aesthetics. So we kind of let it go where we take the teeth out or something, or we scale and replant and hope for the best. Additionally, because of the minimally invasive nature, it's appropriate for multiple defects. When you have several teeth in a quadrant that requires regeneration and everything that you want to put in there, that cost goes way up, and the patient may just say, you know what, just take the teeth out, give me a denture, whatever. Want to find a way to get those multiple defects, because there's no mouth that just has one single defect. Regeneration refers to the reproduction or reconstitution of a lost or injured part, which in contrast to repair describes the healing of a wound by tissue that does not fully restore the architecture or function of the part. So you can repair something or you can try to bring it back to where it was. True regeneration requires new cementum, new periodontal ligament, a new alveolar bone. Last year, Millennium, the developer of LINAC, got a second FDA clearance for true regeneration. This clearance is not based on safety of the machine. It's based on FDA clearance for true regeneration is based on 26 pages of unpublished histology from Dr. Mark Nevin's study. So if you have any questions on it, seek Mark Nevin's out at the meeting and talk to him about it. There's no other laser company, no other laser device, no other laser periodontal therapy that can claim true regeneration. When I'm doing LINAC, I'm not using any biologics. I'm not using any exogenous growth factors. There's no bone graft, no dead people powder, no cow bone, pig bone, horse bone. There's no artificial membranes, there's no scaffold, there's no sutures. Because I deal with patients on a daily basis. And when they hear there's no sutures, they think it's not surgery. And they're more apt to have treatment done. Here's the histology that proves it. This is, again, Dr. Mark Nevin's study from 2014. Beautiful histology. You can see here the Sharpie's fibers directly inserting into the brand new cementum in the correct orientation. And it's not just a surface effect. It's deep into that new cementum. This is a new attachment. This is regeneration of the PDL, and we see alveolar bone regeneration too. The NDAC kills bugs. A lot of the studies, and I've seen Dr. Renver talk, and I've read his book. It's funny, they just only use an erbium. They never really look at NDAC. And then they classify all lasers don't work. Well, not all lasers don't work. It's because you only looked at a certain number. Lanap does, the NDAC is very bactericidal to bugs. This is a study that was done by Dr. Tom McCauley and Dr. Thomas Rams. And what they found was, they did cultures before doing Lanap and before doing ultrasonic debridement, and immediately after, they want to see where those bugs were killed. And they found that 85% of the sites, the periodontal pathogens were suppressed immediately from the Lanap sites. Whereas 100% of the sites of the periodontal pathogens were still present after ultrasonic debridement. So even though your hygienists are cleaning off the calculus, the bacteria are still there. And I remember when I was teaching at Case Western Reserve, the first question that I always told, one of the questions I always had on the exams was, what is the primary cause of periodontal disease? It's bacteria, it's not calculus, it's not smoking. These are contributing factors, but the primary is bacteria. You have to kill the bacteria. I don't care what else you do. This is just Lanap, this is it. So I'm gonna tell you, you've seen probably seen this picture a million times, it's probably been emailed to you and you've probably got a lot of stuff on it. This is basically just the steps. Hey, Deborah. So Deborah, you just had the Lanap protocol done last week, and how did it go?
It was incredible, incredibly wonderful experience.
Did you have any discomfort or anything?
Absolutely no pain. I had no discomfort. I was expecting it, happened.
Good. So would you recommend this to someone else who has gum disease to have their treatment done this
Absolutely.
Way? All right. Great. Thanks a lot. You know, I go to a lot of lectures and I listen to a lot of speakers. And one thing is that they're showing beautiful tenants. I'm going to make huge flaps and I'm going to put in tons of bone graft and we're going to take stuff from the chin. What's missing from them? It's a great technique, but there's someone behind all that surgery. There's a patient there who may have huge amounts of discomfort afterwards. We may get beautiful slides, and wow, look at that, but there's a patient behind that. And I think we forget that sometimes. I treat patients. I treat their perio, but my first obligation is to treat the patient and to give them what I feel is the best treatment for them and to have them have treatment done. So here's some of my cases. If the cases you're gonna see have only been treated once with Lanap or whatever you're gonna see it, Unless this is someone else's case, then I'll tell you who it is. But this is a case that I saw. A lot of bone loss on this patient. Hasn't seen a dentist in years, obviously. He doesn't have much of a choice here. If I cut away his gums, he's going to have the picket fence approach, and he's going to have big spaces, and that's just going to be unesthetic. It's just not going to give him what he wants. I asked him, I said, do you want a nice smile, or do you want to keep your teeth? If you want a nice smile, it's going to be dentures and maybe some implants. If he wants to keep his teeth, I have something I can use for him. I can help him save his teeth. Now, nothing is going to save that tooth there. This is just a blow up. You can see the depth of these pockets. These are 10, 11 millimeter pockets. Scaling root planing is a waste of time and money. Surgery's not an option here for the amount of resection I have to do. Here's what he looked like when he walked in. Now, I will tell you, I still do osseous surgery. If someone up here is talking about Lanap and they say, I don't do osseous surgery anymore, there's two things that are happening. They're cherry picking their cases and they're saying, okay, I'm only gonna do Lanap, I'm not gonna do anything else. Or if they see a case that needs osseous, they send it off to someone else. It's not a cure-all for everything. I still do osseous surgery. The majority of my periodontal disease practice is doing Lanap, but I still have patients that require osseous surgery. I haven't given up that part of my periodontal training. So he comes in, but I will tell you this. I haven't used a curette on a patient in almost 11 years. I don't believe in them anymore. I use a piezo scaler for every one of my cases. So all your cases you're gonna see here have only been scaled with a piezo scaler. I don't over-instrument my cases. So he came in, this is what he looked like the day of surgery, to see the amount of inflammation. But because he has tissue all the way down to the CEJ, I can get a new attachment. I can decrease those pocket dips. We went ahead and we treated him. This is one of the teeth I took out. You can see, look at that calculus that is on there. This is what I was fighting when I was cleaning his teeth. We get a fibrin clot. This is what the hemostasis looks like. 4 weeks later, look how nice that tissue looks. I didn't cut away this tissue. The body resorbed it back to where it's healthy. Here's 9 months post-op. This pocket here, 11 millimeters, and now it's just about a 2. And I'm probing hard, and look how that tissue's blanching. The original pocket depth here was 10, and now it's barely a 5. With one treatment, regular maintenance, that's it. Here he is, almost 4 years later. He still has his teeth. I've converted him to an internally coronal splint for aesthetics. He's kept his teeth. He's a regular patient. This guy does not miss a maintenance appointment. We saved his teeth. That, to me, is what Perio is about, is saving people's teeth. People want to keep their teeth. I don't have a huge implant practice. If I do 100 implants a year, that's amazing. But I probably save thousands of teeth a year. And that's why I got into Perio. Here's another case. This patient is not on medications. That's severe inflammation. You can't cut. You can't do anything. Where are you going to scale? We went ahead and treated him with Lanap, and the only reason I treated him was because I want to get that inflammation down as fast as possible. 6 months later, you can see how that's resolved. Again, one treatment, this is coming for a second maintenance. Tissue's resolved, you can start seeing where he needs to get some restorative work done. His lowers were even worse. The original periodontist was going to take those teeth out, but what are you going to replace it with? You can't take an impression of that type of inflammation. But now, 6 months later, the teeth are back in position. If you want to, you can splint it. It's easily maintained. You can save the teeth. This is what the patient wants. So we all like to see, so we've seen inflammation control, we've seen it's bactericidal, bacteria control. But look, what's happening, because we want to see x-rays, we want to see the bone, that's what we want to see as periodontists. I want to see a picture. I want to see x-rays. So look, this patient hasn't had a lot of dental work done. I mean, there's a lot of different things we can do here. We can do regeneration, they take the teeth out, we can do bone grafts, membranes, we can do implants, whatever, but what if we could save it with minimal amount of work? 12 millimeter pockets, 12, you know, you can see the depth of these pockets that a lot of us won't even treat. Here he is 1 year later, bone regeneration, and the pocket depths are down to pretty much maintainable levels after one treatment. This is a year after Lanap. Saved the patient's teeth, grew his bone back, and got the pockets down to maintainable levels. Here's another case. 13 millimeter pockets, did Lanap. How are we going to treat that? Well, I could try to regenerate, I could maybe take the tooth out, do an implant. That seems to be everybody's, hey, do an implant. Look, 10 months later, the pocket's down, the bone's filling in from the distal side in. 27 months later, the tooth's still in place, the bone's pretty much regenerated. Look how healthy that tissue is. That is a success. Pockets are down to maintainable levels. Did I lose papilla? Oh my God, I lost papilla. I'm not worried about this. It's not aesthetic, but to get this back, I think it would have been, to try to do anything else, I think it would have been a lot worse. This is a more recent case I'm working on now. You can see the amount of bone loss here. We did a localized periodontal therapy here. 5 millimeter point from a 10 to a 5, and look how that bone's filling in. And the majority of you probably would have said, oh, it might be a fracture, or maybe it needs a root canal. It didn't. It just needed to have occlusion check, get the bacteria out, and give the body a chance to do what it needs to do. I don't think there'd be one doctor in this room who wouldn't take that tooth out. Everybody said, take this tooth out on this lady. She's in her, well, at the time, she's probably in her late 60s, early 70s. They said, take it out. And look at the amount of bone loss you have and how much bone you'd have to try to fill it up with. We treated with Lanap because she had pockets other places. I said, figured the worst case scenario is I'm going to take the tooth out, and then I'll graft it and get a bone, get an implant in and everything else. 13 months later, pockets are down, bone is filled. It's a maintainable site. We save the tooth. That's what we're here for, is try to save teeth. I did a Simplant reformatting on her. Here's the defect. There's the bone fill. This is not magic. This is science. It's biology. It may look like I'm waving a magic wand, but it's not. And here's the tooth that everyone said to take out. She liked it so much she went ahead and had Invisalign done. What about this patient here? A lot of you are looking at that and probably thinking, I'm going to take 5, 6 teeth out. Am I right? Everyone said that. Every lecture I give, everyone goes 5, 6 teeth. So I went ahead, I said to the guy, look, I'm going to treat this. I'm going to see what happens. The worst case scenario, if I don't get the result I want with doing LINAP, is I'm going to take the teeth out anyway. I have found, I've been doing LINAP over 11 years, I'm never further behind trying to save it first than with any other procedure. Because if you flap it open and put a graft in, membrane, everything else, and those fail, what do? You're going to cut the patient again, you're going to charge them again for more material, take the tooth out, but if I do it with LINAP, I'm not going to be further behind. So let's look and see what happened. Look at the defect. We're going to look at tooth number 18. Look at the defect on tooth number 18 on that distal. That's a pretty big defect. Here it is 6 months later. Now, it's not completely filled, but the tissue looked good. If the tissue looks good, why am I touching it? Because of an x-ray? No, if the tissue looks good, it's healthy, it's not bleeding, patient's not in pain, and it's not mobile, what am I doing? Just leave it alone. Because if you leave things alone, 8 years later, that tooth is still there. And if we look at tooth number 19 now, the same thing. 6 months later, whatever, maybe take that tooth out, see what happens, whatever, get an implant in. But if you just leave it and let it heal, almost 8 years later, that tooth's still there. Am I gonna get bone all the way top here? Not gonna happen. But I have a maintainable pocket now. The patient comes in for regular maintenance. And he did need a root canal, that tooth that almost everybody says needs a root canal. Saved all his teeth. No teeth were lost on this patient at all. That's a service that I can provide as a periodontist. That's what I want to do. How about this one here? Tooth number 30, greater than 10 millimeter pocket. We brought it down to 5 with one treatment in a year. But here's the defect. That's a pretty big defect. Most of us would take that tooth out, graft it, place an implant, be done. It's predictable. Extraction is the only procedure we have in perio or in dentistry that's 100% predictable, right? I take a tooth out, I guarantee that patient will never grow that tooth back again. But look, 9 months later, that's a pretty good bone fill, even if you're doing regeneration procedures. 2.5 years later, maintenance only, pretty much 100% bone fill, patient has his tooth, maintainable situation, bing, bang, boom, that's beautiful. The vascular nap, we get little to no recession, so we can use it very well in aesthetic areas. Very little to no post-op discomfort. Addresses the periodontitis only mechanically, but at the bacterial level, something that surgery doesn't do. We don't address the bacteria surgically. We're leaving that bacteria within the tissue, within the bone. We get bone regeneration possible without additional grafting material. Therefore, the patient is saving money. They're not spending thousands of dollars to fill in one little defect around one tooth. It's more conservative than traditional surgery, so I have options for retreatment. And I have done retreatment with osseous surgery in certain areas where the tissue just didn't heal the way I want to, so I can go back in and I can do regenerative, or I can do traditional surgery, or I can say, you know what, I'm going to try the LINAP in this particular area again. Because we can get the fibrin clot to form, we don't take patients off blood thinners, making it much safer. And we have a high patient's acceptance rate. It's a surgical procedure, but because there's no scalpel, because there is no sutures, they don't perceive it. Okay, Nathan, so it's been a year since we did the original LINAP, and we did our probiodepths, and they're incredible. All your pockets went down to maintainable levels. How would you describe your experience over the last year and the results that we got?
Well, first of all, my mouth feels great. I see, detect no bleeding whatsoever, and I can eat anything, chew anything, I'm at complete comfortability, and I really appreciate Dr. Hahnemann's help in maintaining my teeth, and also, more importantly, or just as important, he's giving me follow-up instructions of how to maintain a good, healthy gums, and I really appreciate that. Now I have a direction as to what to do.
Good. All right. Fantastic. Would you recommend the LINAP treatment to anybody?
Oh, it's compared to the more invasive of cutting into the gums and or possibility pulling teeth that was suggested by another periodontist. None of that happened with this experience, and I so much recommend it.
Good, thanks. There's a patient behind every procedure we do. Patients would rather try to keep their teeth than get implants. Sometimes implants are required, I'm with that. But the patient would rather try to keep their teeth as much as possible. So, we're gonna get into implants now, right? You know, this is the first group that hasn't laughed at this slide. I'm just letting you know that. Even at the Academy, American Academy of Implant Dentistry, they laughed at the slide. So come on, paradise, you gotta lighten up a bit. So look, we know, at, you know, and Dr. Clem mentioned too, if the bacteria that's involved with periodontal disease is the same, pretty much the same bacteria that's involved with peri-implantitis. You got bacteria, you're gonna get some problems going on, and that's it. I'm not gonna belabor the case. That's a major problem. How major is it? It's huge. It's vagina. Huge. Okay. There are currently, you know, this everybody's got their own little formula out there. You probably went to a ton of meetings on peri-implantitis to try to find some little nugget of, like, help me, how am I going to treat these? But no one has compelling evidence to say, this works every time, this is how you do it. You can use this, you can grind away the titanium, use a burr, and this and that, and or you can throw the kitchen sink at it and charge the patient $5,000 and hope something sticks. Then no one has it. This is my question, and this is something I've been thinking about for the last couple of years, and I've been talking about this. What is the goal we're trying to achieve when we're treating peri-implantitis, or periodontitis for that matter? I look at it this way. I try to treat the itis, the inflammation. That's what this lecture is about, is inflammation. So if I have a case where I get decrease of inflammation, healthy tissue around the implant, and I didn't get 100% bone fill, but pockets have gone down, the patient stopped bleeding, and we stabilized the situation, the implant tissue situation, that's a success. To me, the bone is the icing on the cake. If I can get bone to grow, fantastic. I'm doing my little happy dance for our patients. But if I get healthy tissue around the implant and it's nice and tight, that's a success also, and it's not bleeding. So think about that. Are we trying to grow, are we trying to put bone in so we can have nice x-rays to show our doctors or our lectures? Or are we trying to get rid of the itis, the inflammation? That's the disease. So there's, if we can treat perio, why can't we treat peri-implantitis with the same type of procedure? The laser-assisted peri-implantitis procedure, or what we call a PIP. So here are the cases. Lady comes in, she figures they're not, their implants, I don't have to brush my teeth because I don't have teeth, so I don't have to brush them, their implants, not gonna get decay. But obviously, this is a problem. Severe inflammation, you can see the suppuration, you see the depth of the pocket, it's almost 10 millimeters deep. If I start doing surgery on this area, it's all gonna fall apart, she's gonna bleed everywhere, it's gonna be a bloody mess. So we went ahead and treated the LAPIP procedure. It's a very simple procedure. It's basically LINAC, but for implants. But the problem is that that MDAG may heat the implant. Oh my God, I'm gonna heat the implant. But if you have a Joule counter on your laser that tells you how much energy you're putting in, you can stop, cool it down, bring it back to mouth temperature, and add some more energy, which is what I do. And it works very well. So I don't worry. I worry about overheating the implant, but because I know how much energy I'm putting in, I don't overheat my implant. I have never lost an implant to doing LAPIP around it. Using the NDAG, I've never, and following the protocol, I've never lost an implant to it at all. Here it is, you can see there's the fibrin clot around the implant. This took me 30 minutes to do, okay? Here it is, what is it, 5 weeks later? 3 weeks later, look how it's resolved, the inflammation is resolved. And there it is 11 months later. That's a healthy site. Patient's keeping it clean. I don't have to grind away titanium, but now it's a maintainable site for the patient. That's a success right there. But just isn't enough, we took an x-ray. You can see the bone loss here. 7 threads were exposed with bone. A year later, only 4 threads were. I did not expect to see any bone fill. But I got some. I got some bone fill around it. Icing on the cake. For me, that is what I'm looking for. This is the surprise. A lot of doctors will show you their peri-implantitis cases with surgery on posterior teeth. Last time I checked, We do anterior implants. So you're going to have cases of anterior periodontitis. But what are you going to do there? Are you going to start flapping those areas? Are you going to start degranulating and end up with recession, end up with abutments sticking out of the patient's gum? How do you preserve the aesthetics there? Well, here's a case. Look, this was done over a year. I saw this patient a year after they did the restoration. He was going to see another periodontist, we're going to flap it open, see what's going on, but you're going to see the recession. So I said, let's go ahead, treat it with this laser procedure that I have, and see what happens. Worst case scenario, I can still go back in and do a traditional surgery if I need to, or take the implant out. But look, watch the margins or watch the pillow. We did the day of the surgery, what did I find? Cement. Took the cement off. Cement came right off during our piezo scaling part of the procedure, which also acts like cavitation, which also acts to bubble off and break up the biofilms on the implant surfaces. So I don't care what implant surface I have, I know I'm probably gonna decontaminate enough, it's gonna be fine. It's gonna get rid of that inflammation, it's gonna get rid of that bacteria, and the inflammation is gonna resolve. Here he is 4 weeks later, look at that margin, the margin didn't move, and here he is 2 years later, papilla came back, that's a healthy site. Tissue's tight, tissue's firm, pocket's gone down, but look, I didn't get all the bone fill. I wanted it, but I didn't. That might be all filled with nice, healthy, connective tissue or whatever's in there, because that is a success. I don't look at just that. If you just look at x-rays, you're losing, you gotta look at the whole picture. You can't just look at probing depth, you can't just look at x-rays, you can't just look at pictures. You have to put everything together. Here's another anterior case. Patient came in, she had severe inflammation. Hygienist saw her, we went ahead, I said, I can treat you today, I have 45 minutes, let's get you in. I didn't have to make sure that I had bone material, I didn't have to make sure that I had my right membranes, I had my bio, I didn't make sure, as long as I got my laser, fiber, and my piezo, I'm good to go, I can do it anywhere. So here's the pocket F9, you can see the amount of inflammation, you can see the bleeding. 4 weeks later, we got resolution of the inflammation. 8 months later, it's still looking good, but look at the pocket depth. That was 9 before, and now it's 3, no bleeding. This is a single treatment, no surgery. What about the bone? Here's the defect, right? Look at the bone field here, and look at the bone field here. Do I really need to flap a patient way open and try to put all this stuff inside just to try to get 3 threads of bone and put them through a lot of surgical work? No, I don't have to. Here's another one. Posterior tooth, you can see the infection, and look at the defect there. We went ahead and treated him. Why did we have the defect? Because the lab left a really nice overhanging restoration. After the tissue resolved, the inflammation resolved, we got a beautiful, we can see what the problem was. But now we can at least keep it clean. Here he is, almost 3 years later. This is resolved, bones filled in. And look at the inflammation's under control. This is nice. This is what I love to see. I love to see healthy tissue, thick tissue around the implant. This case here, who knows what would happen? I didn't guarantee anything. I said, this is a goner, and he says, give it a try. What's the worst case scenario? I take it out, that's it. Put a bone graft in, and he's good to go, get a new restoration on this implant here. We treated him. Here he is 6 months later, here he is 9 months later, and here he is a year later. I'm not gonna get bone filled right to the top, not gonna happen. I don't care. I've got some bone filling through here, pretty nice, but more importantly, look how nice and tight that tissue is around those implants, around those abutments. That's a healthy site. It's 4 millimeter pockets. It's maintainable. The implants are still in. It's not pretty underneath, but damn it, we saved the patient's implant. Save them thousands upon thousands of dollars of other treatment that may be required. It's not just me. I'd like to say it's just me and I'm the most brilliant laser periodontist out there, but it's not. It's a protocol with the correct laser wavelength. Look, this is Dr. Michael Thompson. He placed this implant, his median implant, in 2009. 2011, the patient came back in, he looked at it and went, oh my God. He actually tried to take this out, it was still stable. So he says, I'll treat it with the LINAC protocol, but for implants. 4 months later, what is that? 4 months later, it's looking like this. 3 months after that, he's got it restored. That's not bad for one treatment. Get rid of the bacteria, the body heals. That's how we work. Larry Finkbeiner, Dr. Larry Finkbeiner, 2010, he had this implant. He placed this implant 2004, 2010. He saw it came up. It's an anterior again. How are you going to flap this without ruining the aesthetics? You can't. So he treated it. Look, here's the initial. And up through the course of the year, he took x-rays. I don't know if this is 6 months or whatever, but look at 1 year. The bone is back to its original height, pretty much. Is it integrated? I don't know. You got to take it out to check to see. That's not, the patients don't want those out. Dr. Tom McCauley out of Fort Lauderdale. Here's his before. You can see that. A lot of us would take that up. And look at the probing depths. These are 15 millimeter pockets. The majority of us would probably take this implant out. But he decided to use the LePip protocol. He saved it. 2 years later, bones fill. Look at the pocket depths. That's a 15 down to a 3. These are still about 50% to go. He told me it's almost 4 years out now, and the implant's still in there. 4 years, 48 months later, on implant, the majority of us would have taken out with a single treatment of LePip. The advanced LePip protocol, it's a great first-line treatment. You've got to get rid of that inflammation. No one wants to do surgery in infected sites, so I can get in there right away. It's more conservative than traditional surgery. Therefore, I have options again. I can retreat via LePip again, or I can do conventional means if required, or if need be, take the implant out. We gave it a shot. The implant's really loose. Take it out. Aesthetics can contain anteriors. We don't just place posterior implants. We place anterior implants and spend a lot of time in those aesthetics. But you had to treat the peri-implantitis there, and how are you going to do that surgically? Very, very difficult to maintain aesthetics. It's less technique sensitive. I don't have to know how to do a split thickness flap. I don't have to know how to, well, I do know how to do a split thickness flap, but I don't have to know how to make sure it's curly position. I want to make sure that my membrane's really tight and which material do I want to use. I just have to follow a simple protocol. It doesn't take a lot of technique. It can be accomplished as soon as peri-implantitis diagnosis is made, thereby saving time for the patient. Also, I can get it in that day. If I have time, hey, let's get in, let's get out. You don't leave an infection sitting around. And it's less expensive for the patients. The patient's not spending thousands upon thousands of dollars to try to get two or three threads back or whatever and hoping it works. This is a very simple, inexpensive, depends on what you want to charge what you want, but relatively inexpensive procedure. And it's a high patient acceptance rate because, again, it's not perceived as surgery. There's almost no discomfort the next day. I have people drive from Flagstaff down to see me because there's no one up in Flagstaff who does this procedure. So, I'm Dr. Alan Hunnigman. I'm a periodontist. I save teeth. That's what I do, and I'm saving implants now also. I want to thank you very much for your time, and I look forward to any questions that you may have later on. Thank you again.
Sorry, we only have one person left. This has been a fantastic exhibition this morning. And,